there was enough knowledge about circumcision that at the time, the American Academy of Pediatrics did not endorse circumcision. They did not see that as a necessary procedure.
The American Academy of Pediatrics does not recommend a policy of routine newborn circumcision because we found that the benefits are just not significant enough.
So as part of our pediatric training, we had the option of learning about it and performing it or not. And I was open to learning or seeing anything. And so I remember being, you know, as part of my well-child newborn rotation, being taught by someone how to do circumcisions. And once I saw one done, I realized that that was definitely not for me. I felt almost as if I was an accomplice to the violation of someone. I don't think the parents had an idea of exactly what was happening. I'm certain the child had no idea what was about to happen. And the person performing it was so detached from what was happening that I don't think he was even giving it a thought. And I think that that's the cycle of defense mechanism that gets created about this procedure, is that parents will agree to something that they, in my opinion, have no right to agree to, because they are ill-informed about exactly what's going to happen. The baby is, you know, a part of this that is should be the most important part, but it's the one that does not have a voice. And the physician performing the procedure is using some type of mental charade to dissociate himself or herself from the procedure, which then allows them to work in that construct. So I didn't feel like I was participating on something that was helping someone. I didn't feel like we were doing anything good. And in fact, it seemed extraordinarily painful to this baby, even though no one in the room seemed to pay attention to it. I spend a lot of my time nowadays in my career preoccupied with the level of comfort that my patients will have while undergoing procedures and surviving critical illness. So a great deal of time is spent in titrating analgesia and anti-anxiety medications to make sure that you can have painful procedures done to you and survive an ICU stay and not be incredibly traumatized. So now that I think back, 25 plus years to my training days, where no thought was given to the discomfort experienced by a baby, I think that it's so detached from my life right now that I don't know how I would have been able to handle that if I had to do that, or if I had chosen to do that as part of my job. But I think I made the right choice. One of the biggest issues I have with circumcision is the fact that you are taking a completely perfect, normal baby and doing a procedure. I cannot think of any other construct in medicine that should do that. We wouldn't do breast augmentation on a baby girl. We wouldn't do, this past year, I've actually read a lot and informed myself and was educated by a lot of people on the subject. For instance, last year when we talked, I said I wasn't equating male genital cutting with female genital mutilation, and I just don't think I knew enough about female genital cutting or female genital mutilation, because I think that it was an uninformed statement. Because when you think of it, I only knew about genital cutting in girls as it pertains to the most extreme form of sexual repression that you see in some places in Africa or some Islamic cultures. And that is, there is an entire spectrum of genital cutting in girls that does not necessarily means just the complete removal of clitoral tissue and over-sewing of the introitus, and which is a very extreme form, and that's the one that gets a lot of attention. But if you look at the mildest end of the spectrum, let's say that you wanted to allow families to have a ritual, piercing of the clitoral hood because that's part of their culture or part of their religion. That is illegal in this country, and rightly so, because it serves no purpose and it's an invasive procedure, an invasive intervention. So that mildest end of the spectrum of female genital cutting is not equivalent to male circumcision, where there is a substantial loss of tissue and a wound and scarring and so on, and yet that's legal and acceptable. So this is something that, as I've learned more about it, yes, I would totally equate male circumcision with then something that's comparable to the spectrum of a female genital cutting. And this is a country that prides itself in justice and equality and some of the major ethical principles. And today in this country, there is not equality and justice as it pertains to how boys are treated and girls are treated in the context of allowing, or if you think of the latest CDC and AAP statements, not just allowed, but encouraged. And that's very troubling to me.
Yeah.
There's truly no reason to do this procedure. I just can't understand, why this is so ingrained in American society. When you look at the AAP position and its criticism, from pediatric institutions from other countries and pediatricians from other countries, it really highlights the fact that you can only tolerate this procedure if that is the default in your community. So the American people don't give a second thought, to whether or not circumcision is helpful, legal, ethically correct. Because that is viewed as the norm, and any deviation of that norm is something that is fodder for jokes or teasing, or and in other countries it's not necessarily like that, and because that is not their default. So if you went to the Dutch Medical Association and said, I really think you should consider circumcising all your babies because it might reduce the chance of a urinary tract infection by a fraction, maybe the Dutch will say, I'm sorry, we have antibiotics and we don't have to cut everyone to prevent a very treatable and easy disease that girls have much more commonly than boys, and yet they do just fine. So that is not a very good excuse. Using very flawed data obtained in adults in Africa to justify circumcision of newborn children in this country could not be more flawed. This is a terrible, terrible message that you can try to prevent HIV by circumcising boys based on African data. In this country, and yet that's tossed around all the time. Or penile cancer, a disease that is so rare that you're cutting an entire population to try to prevent the very, very, very rare case, which you don't even know if it is preventable by circumcision. In fact, not endorsed by the associations that truly understand the problem of penile cancer. And yet, if someone proposed that women should just all across the board have prophylactic mastectomies because that will lower their chance of having breast cancer, then you will be laughed at. But no one gives a second thought when they're talking about neonatal foreskin. Are we really benefiting newborn boys? How does that correlate with girls? Why do we have two measures in the same society? Why is this socially acceptable? why, you know, can religion be used as a justification for this? Well, obviously not, because there are religious practices in this country that, you know, think that it's okay to ritually cut girls, and yet that is not allowed by law. So to say that boys are okay because, you know, it's been done by for a couple of millennia, and you know, parents are the best decision makers for this patient or for this boy, and it's their religious or cultural practice. Well, that is not a clear justification, and yet that's something that has helped to normalize the acceptance of circumcision in this country.